this video, we will be covering some of the muscles of the thigh and the hip. We'll begin by reviewing the muscle attachments and their actions, which will be visually represented using our skeleton. And then we'll move through a yoga flow that draws attention to these muscle groups. I promise that this is the most material-heavy video, so stick with me as we make our way through. Let's start with the muscles of the hamstrings. The hamstrings are comprised of three muscles, the biceps femoris, semimembranosus, and semitendinosus. All of these muscles proximally attach at the ischial tuberosity. In the case of the biceps femoris, the long head proximally attaches at the ischial tuberosity, while the short head proximally attaches along the linea aspera on the upper two-thirds of the proximal femur. Both the long and short head of the biceps femoris distally attach at the head of the fibula, right here. As you can see, shortening of the biceps femoris leads to extension of the thigh at the hip. Additionally, shortening or contraction of the biceps femoris draws the head of the fibula relatively closer to the muscle's proximal attachment at the ischial tuberosity, which also causes flexion of the leg at the knee. Because the biceps femoris crosses over two joints, the hip and the knee, it's able to enact two different movements over one at each of these joints. The semimembranosus and semitendinosus are very similar to the biceps femoris in the journey they take to their attachments. Both of these also proximally attach at the ischial tuberosity and only differ in their distal attachments. The semimembranosus proximally attaches at the ischial tuberosity and makes its way across to distally attach at the posteromedial surface of the proximal tibia, right here. The semitendinosus also proximally attaches at the ischial tuberosity and makes its way down to distally attach at the upper inner surface of the proximal tibia. Both of these muscles, when contracted, cause extension of the thigh at the hip. Also, as both of these muscles contract, they are able to draw their distal attachment closer to the proximal attachment at the ischial tuberosity, which causes flexion of the leg at the knee. Again, just like the biceps femoris, both of these muscles cross over both the hip and the knee, which means that they are able to cause movement at both of these joints. Moving to the front of the thigh, we have the quadriceps muscles. As the name suggests, the quadriceps is comprised of four different muscles: the rectus femoris, vastus medialis, vastus lateralis, and vastus intermedius. All of these muscles proximally attach along the ilium and the shaft of the femur. They distally attach onto the tibial tuberosity via the patellar tendon. Just like the hamstrings, the quadriceps muscles cross over two joints, the hip and the knee, and therefore are responsible for movement at both of these joints. At the knee, as the muscle shortens, the tibial tuberosity is drawn anteriorly, which causes extension of the leg at the knee. Looking more proximally, contraction of the muscle also causes flexion of the thigh at the hip. Now, continuing down to the lower leg, we'll start talking about the gastrocnemius. This powerful muscle proximally attaches at the distal femur and distally attaches at the calcaneus via the calcaneal tendon. Just like the quads and the hamstrings, the gastroc crosses over two joints, the knee and the ankle, so it causes movement at both of these joints. At the level of the knee, shortening of the muscle causes flexion of the leg at the knee. At the level of the ankle, shortening of the muscle draws the calcaneus superiorly, causing the toes to point down, or plantar flexion of the foot at the ankle. The soleus is a deeper calf muscle. It proximally attaches at the tibia and the fibula, and it also distally attaches onto the calcaneus via the calcaneal tendon. As the muscle shortens, it is responsible for plantar flexion, and you can see this happening as the toes point downward. The next set of muscles that we will cover before moving into yoga poses that cover the lower extremity are the hip flexor and hip extensor muscles. The two major hip flexor muscles that we will discuss are the iliacus and the psoas major. Together, these muscles are known as the iliopsoas. The iliacus muscle proximally attaches at the upper two-thirds of the inner surface of the ilium, up to the inner lip of the iliac crest, to the anterior sacroiliac joint. It hooks over the anterior aspect of the pubic bone to distally attach at the lesser trochanter of the femur. The psoas major proximally attaches along the transverse processes, discs, and bodies of lumbar vertebra 1 through 5, as well as the body of the 12th thoracic vertebra. So that is right here, all along here. Just like the iliacus, the psoas major hooks over the anterior aspect of the pubic bone to distally attach on the lesser trochanter of the femur. The iliopsoas is responsible for flexion of the thigh at the hip. As you can see, by taking this journey over the pubic bone, as these muscles shorten, they are able to lift the lesser trochanter up, and therefore the whole femur is lifted, causing flexion of the thigh at the hip. The gluteus maximus is the major hip extensor that we will discuss today. The gluteus maximus proximally attaches at the posterior surface of the ilium and distally attaches at the gluteal tuberosity of the proximal femur. It also distally attaches along the iliotibial band, although the IT band is not visualized on a skeleton model. As the gluteus maximus shortens or contracts, it draws the femur posteriorly with relation to the pelvis, which causes extension of the thigh at the hip.